Now, for the very last thing that we're going to talk about, it's actually going to be a video. So if you just hold on 1 minute, I'll tee it up for you. Right, so Shane's laughing because he said it's a swimsuit model. And I went, you know, that's Vince McMahon.
I see now, as you say, yeah, they're going to take the specs off here, the cheaters. And but when is that picture taken? Because it does look like...
Oh, that's probably going to be when he was in his 40s or something. It's not about Vince McMahon, this clip, by the way. This is actually from Bubba Army. So this is a Bubba the Love Sponge clip from many years ago with Hulk Hogan on it. So listen to this story. You may want to listen to it twice because it's so nice. But the follow-up question will be quite obvious, but have a listen to this.
Tell me the story, the one time that Vince hid you in his attic for like a month.
That's when the feds were looking for me.
The feds were looking for you to testify against him, and he right?
Yeah, it was a good plan for a while.
I think
Macho was going to stooge us out.
Now, where did he hide you at?
A whole bedroom upstairs, like a whole house upstairs.
And he hid you up there, and were you not allowed to go out in public? You couldn't do any job?
I didn't want to, because I was scared.
Where'd they finally track you down at?
Well, I think, you know, Macho came over to talk to Vince about, you know, whatever, bookings or business, whatever. And Randy and I had this whistle that he used to call his German Shepherd, that like that.
Right.
And like a dumbass, I did it when Randy was in the house to let him know I was upstairs. Next thing I know, the feds were banging on the door 2 days later.
You think he's the one that stooged you?
Oh, I think so.
Gordon Bennett. That's a... do you want to listen to any of that again, or did you get
no,
it?
No, no, I got it. Yeah, it's... never heard that.
Well, you probably never heard it because, I mean, I hate to cast aspersions on Hulk Hogan, but there may have been a little bit of embellishment that he hid in Vince McMahon's attic or upstairs to avoid the federal government for a month or more.
Yeah. Huh. Well, I don't think he's like behind, like you pull the candle and the wall moves type of thing, you know? I don't think it was like that, but...
So have you ever heard of this? Let's put context into this. He's talking about the steroid trial, which happened in 94. Mm-hmm. So I think Hulk Hogan and Vince McMahon fell out August 93, something like that. Mm-hmm. So nearly a year before the trial. So I'm wondering, at what point did Hulk Hogan hang about in Vince McMahon's house for an entire month, avoiding the federal government?
Yeah.
In that sense. And also somehow Randy Savage turned up one day, heard a whistle, and then he stewed. What?
Yeah.
It's fanciful.
It sounds... colorful. It's been so long ago. Again, being young in the business, and you know, the scuttlebutt that was at that time was that Hogan was going to testify against Vince McMahon. And the scuttlebutt in the business was, well, if anybody would know where the bodies are, right, it would be the Hulkster. And when he turned hostile on the stand, you know, there's the old saying, from attorneys, never ask a question you don't know the answer to, right? And, you know, by putting this guy in the stand, you know, once he's up there, you can't say, oh, we're done. Get the hook and yank him off. You know, he's up there to do it. Sounds more to me, if that were the case, that Vince did in some way get to him and say, okay, well, you know, if you do this or do that, you know, we'll open the vault back up for you. And, you know, Hogan, if for nothing else, and I don't say this in any kind of accusatory way, Hogan is one of those rare breeds in the business that could have single-handedly unionized the business or, you know, waved the magic wand and made life better for a whole lot of people. People that worked to get him over, like Kamala and, you know, across the board, everybody. Saturday Night Main Event or WrestleMania, I'm a Great American is playing, and says, hey Vince, let me talk to you. I'm not going to the ring until you sign this or that. The numbers that I recall, I think back in that original run, Hogan made $6 million, I think was the public number that was put out, and made another $14 million that year from endorsements. What would Hulk Hogan have made? Because 93 is the year the NFL started naming a franchise player for each team. And that meant that they had to be paid the average of the top five salaries in that position in the league. In a company, you know, WWF had 100, and let's be generous to them, probably 150 wrestlers under contract at that time. the NFL and the NHL. The NFL has 1,600 players. NHL has 1,400 players. So we're talking 3,000 players. How many front office personnel? How many assistant coaches? How many, you know, trainers and this and that and publicists and all those types of things? Thousands and thousands and thousands of people. There were several years back in the 90s when the WWF outgrossed the NFL and NHL combined. Say that again. More than both the NFL and NHL combined. That's a lot of money. And again, thousands and thousands of people. And the average salaries in those top five spots were pretty big chunks of money even for that time. What would Hulk Hogan, who was arguably by far and away the biggest wrestling name on the planet at that time, been worth? You know, probably could have taken the check and said, just kept adding zeros, you know, and Vince would have had to have paid it. So he did himself a disservice at the same time. My guess would be, knowing Vince like I know him, which is nowhere near as well as I know other people, but knowing of the Mr. McMahon type character and the character that he is, you know, the person that he is running that company, that he, you know, he knows that Hogan knows where these bodies are. Just a question of how did he get a hold of Hogan, you know, with the feds, you know, ringing around him if they were at that time. But no doubt in my mind, there was some kind of backroom deal made there, because, you know, Vince is the kind of person, once you cross him, you're done. And, you know, they're, like you said, they had that falling out, and yet Vince and he have this run past that. And, you know, he's periodically dipped back in there many times. I find it like, I'll stay to the high road and say with your words, fanciful, you know, as a, you know, colorful term used. But yeah, there was definitely some skullduggery, because I remember when Hogan turned hostile on the stand. Like, that was like a in the middle of the trial. Like, everybody thinks it's going a certain way. And, you know, but back to the, like, bring us back to even more recent stuff. If you recall, Vince's, one of his first comments in emerging from the courthouse is he takes off the fake neck brace, right? Ta-da, it's the prop. And he says, I'm Vincent effing McMahon. Well, you know, you don't go to the federal government and go, hey, feds, I'd beat you in court, because they're going to sit back and let's say I'm the guy that's retiring that tried to get him. And I'm not going, oh, let's just tear that fella up. I never got him. I'm going to say to you, the young guy coming in, hey, keep your eye on this guy. And when you retire, keep an eye on that guy and keep passing it down. And, it, you know, sooner or later, the feds are going to get you for something. When you're running a company that big, there's a myriad of different things. There's a saying, an adage over here, that every day the average American breaks the law 100 times a day or something like that. You know, so when you're running a billion-dollar multinational corporation, you know, the feds can get you at some point. You know, just much, much better and much smarter to come out and say, I'm thankful, I'm ready to move on and take the WWF to different heights and get back to the family business, instead of, I'm Vince McMahon and I'm going to screw you. That would be my guess. You know, it certainly sounds auspicious in the way that, you know, it played out there, that, you know, hey, I'm just hiding out in the, you know, I'm seeing like in Young Frankenstein, you know, the scene where they get caught, she gets caught in the wall with the candle and it keeps spinning around. It's, you know, Vince has this hidden lair in his house someplace. And with him, who knows, he probably does.